This is the third one I'm just finishing up here. I don't know if they are watching these or not, but it seems to me he's sort of like shadowing that from. It's just a really good video, actually, just to I think it's today. I think it's today, the one that I've just watched. On the sentencing gap and perhaps why we treat Trump's demand to have Hillary locked up, not seriously, which is a woman, this might actually be some is somehow benevolent sexism. I think she might be right. That was responding to it. I was saying, you know, I think you might be right, and I think it's in the same way, it's a reverse pattern of the fact that when a woman flirts with me, that she can say, oh, I've been stalking you, and that's okay. Answers to go, that's obviously a joke, and it's not threatening. Whereas if I said to a woman who I was flirting with, I've been stalking you, and I go, well, I'm not sure now whether you might actually genuinely mean that or not. And I think that's that thing of, you know, you can say, oh, I'll go lock Hillary up, and he doesn't really mean it, because no one locks women up. Of course, Yulia Tymoshenko was locked up by her political opponent, so it isn't as hollow a threat as... It's not guaranteed that it's a hollow threat. But anyway, so... But it does cover the sentencing gap, it does cover the element of sexism. So I feel that sometimes, and it's actually referencing an article on the Good Men Project that I linked to on the previous year. So I think she might watch them. So if you are, hello. This is just wrapping this one up. Better not be too rude about them, but I...
The suffragettes did undeniably move things forward. The second wave of feminism undeniably moved things forward. The third wave, or the fourth wave, as you may call it, the early third wave was fighting its own fight, getting the definition of rape broadened so it doesn't have to be just a, you know, penis entering a vagina without a consent. It broadened the rape laws so that, you know, men could, under the law, be sexually assaulted, among other things.
Great. Carly, you're so dishonest here. You're so dishonest. Oh! So frustrating. Yeah, it meant that if a man used his finger during foreplay, he's penetrated her, that could count as rape as well. Meant that, didn't it? When you think of what the foreplay equivalent of using your finger is stroke his balls, or, you know, slip your hand inside his pants. Because there's no penetration involved, it's not rape. But the equivalent male thing, slip a finger down there. It's awkward, isn't it? It's one of the difficulties we're talking about. The fine lines between sex and rape. But then at the same time, it's always the difficulty when you read the papers. There's a sexual assault. I've got no idea what it means. I've got no idea what this means. What does this mean? Because it can't be explicit. If you think, what would the actual equivalent for a woman to do in sex, you'd think nothing of it. You'd think nothing of it, slipping a hand down his pants and talking about, you know what I'm talking about? I'm talking during a snog, you know. I'm not talking about as a greeting. I'm talking about during snogging. And of course it could cause alarm. You could go, oh, what? Hold on. A little bit quick there. I wasn't expecting that. It could cause alarm. But you wouldn't call it rape. Having your partner sort of your hand between your legs. You would call it moving too fast, wouldn't you? You'd say it being forward. Because a finger can penetrate. And it can be now interpreted, isn't it? Wouldn't have used to have been. It meant if they had sex and they were both drunk, she could say that was rape because she was too drunk to consent. And that too. You're talking about this broadening of rape laws has been a good thing that's been to the benefit of men. Well, hey, we should all cheer that. All cheer the expanded definitions of rape. And the expanded definitions of rape, Lianna, have made more men potentially labelable as rapists that wouldn't have been before. And many of them aren't. Because they're not violent, not forceful, possibly not even coercive. Well, you know, what is coercion? It's a very broad, very easy to see something as coercion. I've heard some feminists use things like emotional blackmail is a form of coercion. We've got to be saying, oh, I'm gonna, if we're not gonna have sex together, I don't see why we're in a relationship. I think this isn't working out. Or if we're not gonna have sex together, I'm gonna wind up sleeping with something else. And now I am. And then that's emotional blackmail there. And where's the fact he's actually telling you the relationship's not working. He goes, he said he'd leave me if I didn't sleep with him. So it's emotional blackmail. Potentially she can do that. Expanding the definitions of rape was not to men's advantage. Please, Lianna, stop pretending it was. And there was a recent study, I think it was 3 years in a row, might be just 2 years in a row. The CDC found that male experience of rape over the year, or male experience of non-consensual sex the previous year, was the same as women's. But there was equality. Experience of unwanted sex didn't count. A lot of the men's ones didn't count as rape in that particular study because forced to penetrate was not counted. But Hanna Rosin did a good Ask Quiet where she pointed out men are getting raped at the same rate as women. And we should be talking about it. Did we talk about it? No. Hanna Rosin talked about it. And then we talked about it in the men's rights movement, in the feminist movement. Hanna Rosin was the only one who spoke up about it. Hanna Rosin was the only person that spoke about it. Just explain what I mean when I say it didn't count. There was a category within the results tables that said this is rape, and there was a category that was forced to penetrate. So both categories existed, but you had to add them together to work out how much unconsensual sex was going on. They were separated out as two different categories, because there were two different categories in the one women were getting raped more than men. But when you actually added the two categories together, you found equality, which is what Hanna Rosin pointed out. And Kathy Young, of course. But there's a difference in Kathy Young and Hanna Rosin, wasn't in. Kathy Young's, she doesn't really count as a feminist anymore. She's been very supportive, really, of not specifically men's issues, but she's been a dissident feminist for so long, and even the thing she says, I'm not even sure what I profess is feminism anymore. It may or may not be feminism. So yeah, Kathy Young, you'd expect her to talk about it. And she did. Hanna Rosin was an unexpected person to speak out about it. That's saying. She was a lone voice. Expanding the definitions of rape have put a lot of men in danger of false allegations, particularly when it comes to affirmative consent. And I know in your previous video, well, in your Feedback Friday, that I kind of did a video on earlier, you said that your view positive affirmative consent wasn't the way to go. fine. But you're not making a big stand against it, are you? And I wouldn't expect you to. But it's not a women's advocacy issue.
Firstly, I wouldn't blame you because it's not a women's rights advocacy issue.
Actually, see, if we look at Katie Royce makes a very good feminist stand against things like affirmative, enthusiastic consent, from a feminist point of view. The Morning After is a brilliant book. Actually, it's the only reason that I don't call myself an anti-feminist is Katie Royce's introduction to The Morning After. And we go, yeah, I understand what you're saying. Alright, I might as well read this, mightn't I? Because I've been telling this isn't the first time I've said, you know, the introduction to Katie Royce's Morning After is why I don't actually use the term anti-feminist to describe what I am. I will say, I am adversarially critical of feminism. Instead of saying I'm anti-feminist, because maybe I'm not against all feminism. It was Katie Rife's introduction that kind of shifted my mind on it. So I will read it, because a friend has just asked me on Facebook, what do you mean? Can you explain yourself? So I might as well read it. My grandmother lived in a world of manicures, hair salons, and no place to go in the morning. She shopped and played endless card games. The King and Queen of Hearts, spades, clubs, and diamonds, absorbing all her intellectual energy. She was caught in a bad marriage with nothing to fill her days. She missed feminism, Mother told me, by only a few years. It would have saved her. So when I was very young, I thought of feminism as something like a train you could catch and ride to someplace better. My grandmother missed it. My mother caught it. I knew it was all about having your own work before work meant anything to me but the sound of my mother's typewriter behind closed doors. In the 60s, my mother had written Up the Sandbox, an early feminist novel recounting the elaborate escape fantasies of a bored housewife. Feminism had a lot to do with my mother's own escapes. I knew that. She would never let my younger sister and me watch The Brady Bunch because it was sexist. Everyone else seemed to be watching the exotic row of blonde girls file through their adventures, and we felt like we were missing something. When we finally managed to persuade her to let us watch an episode, she would hover over us, reminding us that girls shouldn't want to be just cheerleaders. My grandmother used to tell my mother that when you're on a date, you should laugh at a boy's jokes. You should make conversations about the things he is interested in, and you should pretend everything he says is interesting, even if it's not. You see, it was more complicated back then, my mother told me. Now you just have to be interesting yourself. My younger sister and I went to an all-girls school for 13 years. As we neared high school, we began to complain about being sequestered from the normal libidinous jostle of co-education. We wanted boys in our classes, but our father said he wanted his daughters to learn to speak their mind. So we learned to speak our mind instead of worrying what the boy in the third row might think, much to our dismay. This is where I come from. I didn't spend much time thinking about feminism. It was something assumed, something deep in my foundations. When I got to Harvard in the fall of 1986, all of that changed. I found something called feminism that was unfamiliar to me. The feminism around me in classrooms, conversations, and student journals was not the feminism I grew up with. The Take Back the Night marches and the sexual harassment peer counseling groups were alien, and even sometimes at odds with what I thought feminism was. All of a sudden, feminism meant being angry about men looking at you in the street and writing about the colonialist appropriation of the female discourse. At Harvard, and later at graduate school in English literature at Princeton, I was surprised at how many things there were not to say, at the arguments and assertions that cannot be made, lines that cannot be crossed, taboos that cannot be broken. The feminists around me had created their own rigid orthodoxy. You couldn't question the existence of a rape crisis. You couldn't suggest that the fascination of sexual harassment had to do with more than sexual harassment. You couldn't say that Alice Walker was just a bad writer. And the list of couldn'ts went on and on. Listening to feminist conversations in and out of class, I was surprised at how fenced in they were, how little territory there was that could actually be disrupted. I remember sitting for a workshop on date rape freshman year, thinking, this is not me. This has nothing to do with me. naive female victim in the film being shown as worlds away. Her 50s-style dates were not the kind of dates my older sister went on. She was passive and innocent, and overly impressed by the boy's intelligence. She didn't drink. It might as well have been a documentary about the mating habits of the fruit fly. The thing I didn't know then was that the mating rituals of a rape-sensitive community and the attitudes that went along with them would be a part of feminism as I experienced it from then on. A new bedroom politics had entered the university. Fighting date rape and sexual harassment seemed to unite and inspire the feminists around me. Everything was cut and dried. It was feminists against the backlash, us against them, and increasingly, I was them. As I see it, there are more than two sides to any issue, and feminists are closer to their backlash than they'd like to think. The image that emerges from feminist preoccupations with rape and sexual harassment is that of women as victims, offended by a professor's dirty joke, verbally pressured into sex by peers. This image of a delicate woman bears a striking resemblance to that 50s ideal my mother and the other women of her generation fought so hard to get away from. They didn't like her passivity, her wide-eyed innocence. They didn't like the fact that she was perpetually offended by sexual innuendo. They didn't like her excessive need for protection. She represented personal, social, and psychological possibilities collapsed, and they worked and marched and shouted and wrote to make her relevant for their daughters. But here she is again, with her pure intentions and her wide eyes. Only this time it is the feminists themselves who are breathing new life into her. This book is not a scientific survey of campus life, measuring the immeasurable with statistical certainty. This is not a comprehensive, encyclopedic sociological analysis. It is not a political polemic. I am not a camera, to invert Christopher Isherwood's famous narrative metaphor. I cannot offer the objective truth, unfiltered from my own opinion. I have written what I see, limited, personal, but entirely real. I have written my impressions. This book comes out of frustration, out of anger, out of the names I have been called, out of all the times I didn't say something I was thinking because it might offend the current feminist sensibility. But there is something else. My grandmother and her card games, her hand turning over card after card, digging faster and faster, memorizing numbers. It is out of the deep belief that some feminisms are better than others that I have written this book. I think that kind of made me think, well, actually, I'm not an anti-feminist. I'm anti a current trend in feminism, and one that makes out the women are victims and men are perpetrators. Feminism that is more driven by melodramatic way of looking at the world than about liberating anyone, women or men. Not that feminism has any requirements to liberate men, it's not its function. That's our function. But there's a feminism around now that's driven by threat narratives, but Katie Roy speaks of a different feminism. She talks of a feminism that failed to liberate her grandmother because it didn't come soon enough and did liberate her mother. It also meant that she was restricted from watching the Brady Bunch. I've forgotten that element on there. I think there were probably things that I was forbidden from. I was taught not to like James Bond. That James Bond shouldn't be elevated to any hero status. That's probably not a bad thing, really. He's a sociopath, James Bond. I much prefer Indiana Jones anyway. I prefer Indiana Jones because he makes mistakes. And I quite like that about Indiana Jones. I like the fact that, you know, when he knocks out a German guard and tries a uniform and it doesn't fit him. Whereas, you know, if it was James Bond, it would fit perfectly, but, you know, Harrison Ford does it, and he goes, bloody hell, I'm going to knock out another one now. and I liked that about him. I liked his fallibility, and that's why I find Indiana Jones a much more interesting hero. But, of course, the reason I was discouraged from liking James Bond is because he treated women poorly. So, you know, I had taboos and restrictions for feminism that I grew up with. In the same way as Katie Royf had some taboos and restrictions on hers. And my mother worrying about her getting sexist ideas from Brady Bunch. My mother was worrying about me getting sexist ideas from watching James Bond. But those sort of restrictive taboos were not nearly as damaging as the threat narratives revolving around rape culture and date rape and sexual harassment. Those threat narratives were seriously damaging, and that's the feminism I oppose. And I've never had a problem with anything that is liberating. I don't have a problem with the feminism that liberated women. I think men should have something the same that liberates men. The reactions of other feminists to Katie Royf's book and the way she was treated, and the way she got death threats from feminists, then you'll be treated the same. So I don't know. I'm not citing about that. I actually, let me off topic again. I appreciate what you did for Gamergate, and I appreciate the fact that you made sacrifices in that you have created a lot of enemies that you could have done without, and you created a lot of enemies for yourself kind of on the behalf of the Gamergaters, and I do appreciate that. This is why I'm now criticizing you. This is somebody, it's respectful criticism. I hope it comes across as respectful criticism. Even if I do tease something. I might not. Can't resist a joke. If I find something funny, I've got to laugh at it. Katie Royf makes a good case in her introduction to the book that there's something called feminism that one feels one should be supportive of. A feminist response to Katie Royf's book makes a good case. There is something called feminism that is very, very important to be opposed to. And I don't feel that the case you made for something called feminism was very convincing at all. I don't think you like your feminism. There is a type of feminism I'm even more opposed to than yours. And then what Katie Royf is calling feminism in her introduction is something I'm actually broadly supportive of. But I think the feminism she's describing is closer to Wollstonecraft's feminism. In the second wave, it was an aspect of second wave feminism. Actually, I'm not sure that Katie Royf's feminism was more Betty Friedan than Wollstonecraft, to be honest. Oh yeah, so Katie Royf makes a good case against affirmative enthusiastic consent. It came from a feminist perspective, so you could make a feminist argument against it. However, mainly, it's a men's issue, because it's men that are most likely to be tarred as rapists when they're not what most of us consider to be rapists. I can understand why you don't want to make a stand against it. You don't want to be accused of being a rape apologist. You don't want to feel that you're being supportive of people that could be considered to be rapists. You don't even be seen as being supportive of people that could be considered to be rapists. Even Naomi Wolf's been accused of not being a feminist anymore, just because she said she didn't think Julian Assange was guilty. But don't pretend these expanded definitions are to men's benefit. It might be in some limited cases, but in the majority of cases, not going to be. Same with actually Vera's talking about, you know, emotional coercion, emotional domestic violence. That would mean a lot more men could claim they're victims of domestic violence. Except, you know, that's not going to turn out. If I said, I'm been experiencing emotional violence in the home because my girlfriend tells me not to see certain friends, and she complains if I get home late from work, she wants to know where I am. I think she's losing control and behaviour. I mean, no one's going to take that seriously. I don't think I'd take it seriously as a woman. So expanding the definitions doesn't help me. Expanding the definitions so that it encompasses things that happen to men doesn't really help men because it's still going to be considered more serious when it happens to women. So expanding definitions of rape so that these are things that can happen to men too. Yeah, but they're also things that men could be accused of doing whilst being unaware they're doing them. And that puts men in more serious danger of false allegations than it does giving men the chance to make allegations themselves. And it's also expanding. It's also part of the war on intimacy. Yeah? I think we should all be making something into the war on intimacy. I think that's very sad. It's a very sad aspect of the way society is going. I'm going to go off on topic here slightly. Off topic here and stop talking about Lianas for a moment. It's all about you, Lianas. I'll get back to you in a moment. A friend of mine wrote an article. She's a feminist. She's not particularly the Sandra's feminist. She thinks I hate women now, obviously. But she was very supportive. When I was talking about demonization and deadbeat dads and stuff, she was actually very supportive of that. She was very supportive of some of my father's right stuff. She was her own father. Split off from divorced, had a divorce with her mother, and the mother then tried to press for child maintenance, and it ruined him. She ruined him. And she thought she was doing the right thing all along. And so she saw that. She saw how the child maintenance laws ruined her father. So when I was talking about that, there was a lot of, I'm doing the man up type stuff. She said, no, you've got to talk about this. You've got to talk about this. She was very supportive of talking about that. So that made me kind of think, oh, she's on board with men's rights. It's really good. But she kind of backed up. When I started expanding my discussion of men's rights and beyond the stuff about child maintenance into the stuff about forced rape allegations and things like that, she then began to decide that I was actually a misogynist. And she became less supportive of my men's rights talk. And then she wrote an article recently, and it was about Victoria Beckham kissing a child on the lips. And this being the whole internet going crazy about Victoria Beckham kissing a child on the lips and suggesting it was paedophilic in some way. And it's very funny because in my family, you don't kiss children on the lips. That is kind of a taboo. You don't kiss your kids on the lips. Kissing on the lips is something that adults do to each other. You don't kiss children on the lips. And I kind of thought that was how it was normally. And then I have, since then, when I was about my 20s, and a friend of mine, her mother, and she wanted me to kiss her daughter at night. And I went to kiss her on the cheek. She said, don't kiss her on the cheek. Yeah, probably. What? And she said, just a peck on the lips. I was going, no, we don't do that. That's weird. It's weird you don't kiss children on the lips. And I kind of thought, well, it's because she's Spanish. That's what it is. It's because her mother's Spanish. And they'll say, social etiquette gets passed down mother to daughter. So she has inherited a more Latin culture there where it is normal to kiss children on the lips. I kind of figured that's what it was. So anyway, I don't know if that's true or not. I don't know if it is the case. I mean, in my Anglican culture, we don't kiss children on the lips. That is a too intimate between a parent and a child. And certainly between a friend of a parent and a child. So I kind of don't like that. Anyway, so it turns out my friend who's writing this article does kiss her daughter on the lips. She thinks it's normal. Why shouldn't I not kiss my daughter on the lips? It's horrible, but we've been used to this. Oh, blimey. Okay. So the war on intimacy has finally affected you. It's finally affected you. And you're writing an article about how awful it is that this has finally affected you. Great. Is it, you smelling some smoke up there? Because we're fighting fires down here. That's how I kind of felt about it. I actually felt a bit bitter about it. I felt a bit bitter that this was a friend who hadn't been supporting me when I was talking about the demonization of men. In fact, where everything, every male behavior is treated as if A, it's sexually motivated, and B, it's creepy. And you know, I, as a father, can't even stand
in a play park watching my kids play on the playground without people thinking, well, is that a pedo over there? And she's complaining that she can't kiss her daughter on the lips without people thinking maybe they're the same people. Yeah, I'm just staying in a bloody park. I don't have to kiss my kids on the lips to be considered to be a suspect. You've got no idea. You've got no idea what it's like to be demonized. Actually, as a woman, you've got no idea of the mole panic and how it affects everyone. But it affects men particularly badly. All right, back to you, Lianas. All right, so that's just about my friend. Yeah, the expansion of definitions of rape have not been helpful to men. They've not been helpful to men. Yeah, I could claim, oh, somebody did something to me. Somebody straddled me in a nightclub while I was drunk. It was sexual assault. But no one's going to take that seriously. It happened as well, and I wouldn't claim it was sexual assault anyway. Because I was asking for it. I wasn't actually asking. I kind of implied that it would be alright. But not right there and then. I expect when I said I found attractive, I didn't mean right there and then. Anyway. But if the genders were reversed, it would clearly be inappropriate behaviour. I mean, I would say it was inappropriate behaviour. It would clearly be inappropriate behaviour if the genders were reversed. It would be considered inappropriate behaviour if I'd even put my hand on her knee. That's the crazy thing. You know, she didn't put her hand on my knee, she straddled me. And that line, that sort of thing, it doesn't matter. I don't care. Expanding definitions has just made more opportunities of accusing men of being predatory. It hasn't increased the opportunities for men to talk about their own experience of being victims of predatory behaviour. As I said before, I experienced proper sexual harassment when I was at school. When I say proper, I mean it was ongoing. Repeated campaign, sexual harassment, same people. They knew full well that I didn't like it. Yeah, I know what proper campaign of sexual harassment is like. And I do find that then people go and talk about wolf whistling as if that is sexual harassment. Run up wolf whistle by something they've never seen before. That's not sexual harassment. At worst, that's annoying. And really, that's no more annoying than somebody shouting bananas at you in the marketplace. Jesus Christ, you need to do that. That's kind of annoying as well. Same thing, really. Trying to sell their wares, aren't they? Yeah, expansions of definitions of what is and isn't sexual assault do not help men at all. They just give women more opportunities of accusing men of sexual assault. And the more the definitions expand, the more likely it is that he is not aware that he has done anything wrong, and that his intentions were not at all malicious. And the more likely it is it's just something in her head. Coerced. I thought I couldn't say no because it would hurt his feelings and therefore I was coerced. It was emotional blackmail. Can't be that responsible for what goes on inside somebody else's head. I won't be taken seriously if I said, oh, somebody wolf whistled me. I feel like I've been harassed. I'm not going to take that seriously. The women get wolf whistles and they can call it harassment. People will take that seriously. Expanding the definitions don't help me. Because they're only as taken seriously as it happens to women. Expanding definitions only gives women more ways in which they can accuse men of being predatory. Doesn't help men because we can't see men as victims anyway. Even if that is an experience that men experience just as often as women do. Or perhaps even more often than women do. It won't be seen as being bad if it happens to a man. Even if it does fit the definition that is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. I don't want definitions of abuse to get bigger and bigger and bigger. I want just the serious things to be treated as serious. And trivial things to be treated as trivial. I'm not that keen to be seen as a victim. I like the times when I have genuinely been a victim to be taken more seriously.
but expanding the definitions to give me more opportunities to be a victim aren't helpful to me. They just give women more ways of seeing themselves as a victim.
But, you know, that wasn't why they did it.
I should hear her out before I start making comments. I realize that now. Yeah, it isn't why they did it. I'm glad you recognize that. No, they did it for exactly the reason I said. So they had more ways of accusing men. They didn't do it to give men ways of accusing women. In fact, that will be what the change will be. When men's experiences of sexual assault and sexual harassment are taken seriously, and they realize how guilty women are, on a very large scale, they might start saying, oh, perhaps we made the definition too broad, perhaps we need to take a map of it. But they only start taking a bag when men's victims are taken seriously. We as a society don't want the definitions expanding. Because if the definitions expand, then we're going to reduce our chances of just normal human intimacy. And that'd be sad. I came up with a soundbite today. I said, love is like tea. It doesn't brew in cold water. And the feminists are very worried about people getting scalded, so they're banning hot water.
There's things like, well, it's too graphic. I won't get into it here, but, you know, that's what early third wave stuff did. And it was the move from advancing women as a class through things like Title IX, which is flawed, and the failed Equal Rights Amendment, and the concept of equal pay for equal work and Roe.
Equal pay for equal work was not third wave. Equal pay for equal work was second wave, and second wave achieved it. What the third wave has done is they've taken the gender earnings gap and presented it, misrepresented it as a gender wage gap, and claimed that it was to do with unequal pay for equal work, but it doesn't represent unequal pay for equal work. It represents unequal pay for unequal work. And that's why I ain't going to go away. I ain't going to go away until women are considered. Women have to take on an equal responsibility for breadwinning as men did. And that's not going to happen. I don't think it's ever going to happen. Not until men start giving birth and lactating, which is going to be a completely, we'll be a different species by then, aren't we? It's not going to happen.
Versus Wade, things like that. The third wave was originally about the individualized female experience. And that's tricky because it's such a mosaic. And this fourth wave, this internet phenomenon that may or may not eventually be seen as its own thing, it's umbrellaed into third wave now. Because anyone can call themselves a feminist, just like, you know, they're like any ideology, it's not present your papers, there's no certification process. People are all on their own journeys. And just because someone identifies as a feminist does not mean that they're not still working through their own sort of gendered soup within their head, you know? And each individual person has to come to their own conclusions about what they think, you know, perfect equality looks like, and that's tricky, right? Because it means stepping away from things like women and children first. Children, you know, are a given, but that you know, that came from an era where it was a different time, you know. And while it's quite tempting to lean back on the idea of women and children first and score those political points of, oh, how can you say that to a woman? It ends up hurting female leaders in the long run.
You know, we've got to talk about Hillary there, haven't we? I know you say you're not a supporter of Hillary Clinton, but you have made some very Hillary Clinton supportive statements. And I'm not a fan of Trump. I would be supporting Jill Stein if I was American, which I'm not, and neither are you, so he doesn't face either of us. But if I was American now, I'd be voting Jill Stein. And I won't be voting Jill Stein because she's a woman. I'd be voting Jill Stein because her politics most closely resembles mine, which I think is the reason why people should be voting when they vote. Watching Hillary play the vagina card over and over again. Bernie Sanders is accused of being sexist because he won't let her interrupt. He says, excuse me, I'm talking, when she tries to interrupt him. But when Trump interrupts her, he's sexist too. So Trump is sexist for interrupting her. Bernie Sanders is sexist for not letting her interrupt. So sexism there is being used to say it's okay for women to interrupt men. In fact, men should let women interrupt. Men have a duty to let women interrupt. But men can't interrupt women. Sexism again. Use sexism both times. To say that it's okay for women to interrupt men. It's not okay for men to interrupt men. She's been claiming things are sexist. Trump says she's a nasty woman. And that's supposed to be sexist. She said she's a nasty woman. But he's not saying all women are nasty women. He didn't call her a bitch. He just said she's such a bitch. Even then, he wouldn't be saying that all women are bitches. He'd be saying, Hillary Clinton's a bitch. But he didn't say she's a bitch. He said she's a nasty woman. There's nothing gendered about that, apart from the woman bit. And the woman bit isn't the bit that's saying the same old woman. The adjective nasty could apply to either men or women. He'd say such a nasty man. In fact, men are often referred to as being nasty. A nasty man. Don't let the nasty man upset you. Yeah, I think it is negative for women to have. I think benevolent sexism is negative to female politicians. There's a little video. I'll play it now. Why not play it now? Do it now. Why say? I'll do this in a future video. No, I'll do it now. Okay. So here's a video of an incident that was supposedly sexism. And I want you to watch out for the sex. I think there's some sexism in here. I want you to watch out for it.
I hope the Honourable
okay, this is David Cameron, former Prime Minister of Britain.
The Member of Parliament for Dartford. Yes, he's no longer an MP because he lost the election, I'm afraid, because of a Conservative candidate. But he's now a GP. He says, calm down, dear.
And this is the supposed sexism that wasn't. He has told Angela Eagle to calm down because she tried interrupting him while he was talking.
GP says this. My discussions with fellow GPs reveal overwhelming enthusiasm for the... I said, calm down. Yes, calm down, dear. I'll say it to you if you like.
And this is Ed Balls. And Ed Balls is actually being sexist. Because he's now insisting that David Cameron make an apology.
Whose rights I'm interested in protecting. A brief answer, the Prime Minister.
It's a very brief quote. From a Labour MP who's now a GP, who said, my discussions with fellow GPs reveal overwhelming enthusiasm for the chance to help shape services for the patients they see daily. That is what Labour MPs, now acting as GPs, think of the reforms. That's what's happening. And I have to say, I'm not going to apologise, you do need to calm down. What I would say to the Honourable Gentleman, in the week...
Look, he's still going. He's still insisting that David Cameron apologise for telling somebody to calm down when they are interrupting him while he was talking.
which makes a here's very a question. Bad impression. Would Ed
Balls do that for a male politician? A I think the male colleague. Would he do that? William Cash. Now, Angela Eagle, as we later discovered when she made a leadership challenge to Jeremy Corbyn, who replaced Ed Miliband as the leader of the Labour Party, when she made her leadership challenge, she revealed herself to be a complete and utter incompetent idiot that plays the victim card in order to discredit the opposition. The opposition in question being the leader of her own party. So maybe she does need somebody to protect her, somebody to champion for her, because she wouldn't be able to cope alone. Then she shouldn't be a politician, should she? There are female politicians like Glenda Jackson, who's fantastic. You should hear her speech when almost everyone in Parliament was kissing Mrs. Thatcher's recently deceased backside. She made a wonderful speech about how damaging Mrs. Thatcher was. Yeah, Glenda Jackson could probably have, if she wanted to, quipped something back at David Cameron. David Cameron's Calm Down Dear, by the way, was a reference to a advertising slogan from a few years back. And of course, it's considered to be sexist because he's called a deer. But as he said to Ed Balls, I'd say it to you if you like. Calm down, deer. Because the deer doesn't refer to the fact she's female, really. It refers to the fact that she's been hysterical. If a man is being hysterical, he's equally asking to be called deer. So it's David Cameron saying, I'm not being sexist. Who is being sexist, though? It's Ed Balls. Ed Balls is performing a duty for Angela Eagle he would not perform for a male colleague. Angela Eagle was making a fuss while David Cameron was trying to make a speech. Now, I'm not a big fan of David Cameron. Actually, I'm not a big fan of David Cameron's politics. But there's been one or two instances where I said, well, actually, he shows some honourable qualities. One of them, when a lot of virtue signalling going on with various leaders of the parties and other politicians, wearing This Is What a Feminist Looks Like t-shirts because some charity had got politicians to do that and do photo opportunities wearing this t-shirt saying This Is What a Feminist Looks Like. David Cameron refused to wear one and said, it's not for me to decide whether I'm a feminist or not. I think that's for other people to decide. If there is a feminist that looks at me and looks at my policies and what I do and how I treat women and thinks that man's a feminist, then that's fine. You can think that if you like. If there's somebody that thinks I'm not, that's fine too. It's not for me to decide whether I'm a feminist or not, because me going around claiming to be a feminist is just virtue signalling. Judging by my actions, not by what I label myself. I think that was quite right. I mean, that was a very respectable decision to make. So I do have some respect for David Cameron. But he's not on my side. Politically, he's not on the same side of the political spectrum as I am. But here, again, he was accused of being sexist for this. He wasn't being sexist. He was being sexist. Ed Balls. Yes, it's removed from Angela Eagle the opportunity to prove herself at being able to stand up for herself, which is a quality you'd need as a politician. As a politician, you should be able to stand up for yourself. As we know from a later campaign, she doesn't like that approach to politics. The approach to politics she likes is playing the victim and lying about bricks being thrown through her window and claiming that she's been victimized and given death threats, when in fact the brick was not thrown through her window at all. None of the things that seem to be claimed to be threats by her actually turned out to be threats. I mean, one of them was, as I say, this text by Owen Jones saying,
if you get rid of Jeremy Corbyn this close to him being elected with such a huge majority of the membership of the party, and you do so by underhand means, you will bring the whole party into discredit and no one takes it seriously. Stood it back years. He's like, that was considered to be a threat. It wasn't a threat, it was a warning. Anyhow, there we go. Benevolent sexism in Parliament. No one calls that out. Everyone calls out the supposed sexism of David Cameron telling somebody to calm down because they're trying to interrupt him. Everyone calls that out. That becomes national news. There's benevolent sexism going on there. Benevolent sexism, Red Bull, no one calls it out. No one notices benevolent sexism. It goes under everyone's radar. They even think that women deserve it. Yeah, it's a problem for women in politics. I mean, you know, it always makes you think women shouldn't be allowed in politics, not until we sorted this out and stopped this sort of white knighting going on. You can't have this white knighting going on and having women in politics at the same time. It's detrimental to the democratic process. In fact, the demonization of the men's rights movement has all been benevolent sexism. Benevolent sexism has been used to demonize the men's rights movement because we're all misogynists, apparently. And that makes us a threat. The reason that makes us a threat is because everyone's worried about women's welfare. Although I have noticed a massive cultural shift in the last year or so, actually in the last few months, over the release of Red Pill. I saw a great little panel discussion on Australian TV, where they were talking about it being banned, how it's been banned, and there was one lone feminist there saying, no, it should be banned, it's a hate speech. And she was one out of a panel of five, and the other four were arguing with her. And that was a massive rebalancing of power, because normally it was the people speaking on behalf of the men's rights movement would be in the minority, the majority would be those sort of feminists that were saying, no, this is threatening to women in some way, so we must stop it. It's a massive cultural shift. Interesting time.
Because it does mean they're taken less seriously. It does send that message that there is a lowered expectation for women, that women can't take it the same way a man can. And that may have short-term benefits for a great many women, but when it comes to those upper echelons, those leadership roles, you know, hyper-competitive spaces, there is no room for treat her like a lady.
Absolutely. I'm glad you're getting this. Does Hillary get this? No. At the moment, Hillary is using that, isn't she? She's using that thing. Like, you don't talk to a lady that way. Treat her like a lady. And anyone not treating Hillary like a lady, anyone criticising Hillary is accused of not treating her like a lady. They're accused of being misogynistic or being sexist. Whereas in fact, the opposite is true. It would be sexist not to criticise. It would be sexist not to say, hey, I am talking, do you mind? It would be sexist not to do that. Because you do that as a man. It wouldn't be an outrage if Trump had said that Obama was a nasty man. I don't even think he'd been accused of racism. I don't think Obama very rarely played the race card. I can't remember an instance where Obama played the race card. I suppose I'm not putting all that au fait of American politics to notice a point at which Obama played the race card. He could have done, but he didn't. He placed the woman card all the time. If it is going to have a negative effect on her being taken seriously, she's not worried about that at the moment, is she? I wonder when it will kick in. Now, you see, I grew up. He always keep claiming I grew up. I grew up throughout my teens, certainly, with a female prime minister. Female prime minister we all hated. I say we all hated. We didn't all hate her, because otherwise she wouldn't have got in term after term after term. You know, at least a third of the population didn't hate her. quite a lot of us really hated her. And she was a milk snatcher. She was the cause for millions of people to lose their jobs. She was vicious. We never felt that we had to treat her like a lady, because she treated us like scum. In fact, she didn't benefit from benevolent sexism at all. Or if she did, she benefited from benevolent sexism very, very briefly. Formidable, the politician. Yeah, I don't know. She never really used the woman card. She never accused anyone of misogyny because of the things they call. I don't know. Be interesting to see how it turns out of Hillary. I think she's very likely to be the next president, isn't she? Be interesting to see how things turn out. But certainly, what we can't have is a president that you can't speak out against, that it's socially taboo to speak out against. That would be very dangerous. It wouldn't only be very dangerous, but it wouldn't only mean that she's not taken seriously as a politician. It would mean that she would be a tyrant. Because it's very important that whoever is in power is somebody that we can criticize publicly and freely.
Now, that doesn't mean, you know, that is separate. Actually, it's not. The idea, if you wouldn't do it to a guy, don't do it to a woman. And that leads into the discussion of, are there things we really shouldn't be doing to guys? And this whole idea of civility and appropriate conduct and boundaries and things like that. But we can't have that discussion as long as we adhere to a double standard. And that is the very tricky, unpacked exploration of the idea of sexism I wanted to present. Now, this is probably very different than what you've heard from other scholars. And here's why. Remember I said that we can't just replicate the actions of previous waves? Well, our regurgitative education system encourages that. The fact that academia is based on citations and you can't use an idea unless it's a collection of other ideas that other people have had leads to echo chambers that are controlled by the various institutions. So a good women's studies program or gender studies program will expose people to multiple types of feminist thought, you know, including people like Camille Paglia, Christina Hoff Sommers, as well as the, you know, the dork side and some of the second wavers, you know, the Betty Friedans and the Simone de Beauvoirs and, you know, the fundamental reading.
If it was a women's study program, then it'd be great, wouldn't it, if Camille Paglia was on the reading list and even Christina Hoff Sommers is on the reading list. Actually, I'm kind of surprised you said Christina Hoff Sommers. You know, I'm almost inclined to think you said Christina Hoff Sommers because you wanted to step up to the game gayers who like Christina Hoff Sommers, but she hasn't actually written much on feminism, has she? She's written a book, Who Stole Feminism? Which is really her talking about what she doesn't like about the way feminism was going, and the war against boys, which is really more of a men's issues book. I say really like that. It really is a men's issues book. She's not talking about a men's rightsy perspective, but it isn't a men's issues. Wendy McElroy would have been a good person to suggest. Because Wendy McElroy has spoken as a feminist in her distant feminism. Daphne Pate and, that's how you pronounce it, Donna Laflamboy's. If it was gender studies, not women's studies, why isn't Warren Farrell on the course? Why isn't Robert Bly on the course? Why isn't Jack Kammer on the course? Or even Peter Lloyd?
got to ask, haven't you? Surely the views of men's rights activists are just as applicable to gender studies as the views of feminists. Because we're discussing gender too. Oh, I'd be particularly concerned if the only representation of men's issues was somebody like Michael Kimmel, who has a perspective on men's issues that is very anti-male, in my view. Orrin Fowle's views are very similar to those of Karen DeCrow, saying Karen DeCrow is a feminist. Karen DeCrow wrote any books. In fact, you know, Katie Reif, who I still think is marvellous, I'll still recommend her book to anyone to be read. That's fine for women's studies, even gender studies. It's not just enough just to have different feminist voices in gender studies. If you're doing gender studies, you need to have some men's rights voices as well. You need to understand what masculinity is as well. You need to understand how males disadvantage in society as well. Otherwise, you're getting half the picture. And it's not true to say all studies are men's studies. They're not. Study of physics is not a study of men. It's a study of physics. It may have been studies done by men, but they weren't studying what it means to be a man. They were studying what it means to be a meson particle, what it means to be a quark, what it means to be a photon. I didn't say what it means to be a man. But the nearest thing is psychology, but psychology studies what it means to be human. It hasn't been in men's studies.
But a lot of places don't. A lot of places limit the course lists, you know, because of this, whatever you want to call it. There is gatekeeping in academia. And so the quality of the programs, because there's no certification program at the end, it's a you know, an interdisciplinary liberal arts degree, there's no quality control. And most people, they go in, they get their degree by regurgitating, they get out and they continue to regurgitate. That's not the realm of creatives. Creatives create. And so what I'm hoping to offer people is some new thinking here. Yes, based on an awareness of what's come before, but we need to continue to evolve and continue to challenge. You know, feminism is not a gospel. It shouldn't be treated like a religion. It's not. And when you start treating it like a religion, you're doing it wrong. It's always question, always. The entire thrust of feminism historically has been questioning what it means to be a woman. And sometimes the act of asking the question is more important, more profound than the whatever answer you come to. It's that whole imagination is more important than knowledge kind of idea. And I think we have to be, what the third wave was defined as early is an idea of mosaic femininity, stepping away from this idea of women as a class and, you know, these tropes, these archetypes, defining the dialogue, broadening the idea of what individual women can be.
Yeah, I think there's a slight problem with the choice feminism, which is not a slight problem, it's quite big, is the implication of choice feminism, because we could all choose what we want to be as individuals. Theoretically, but the inference is that men already have choices, and it's women that need to fight to have choices. Well, I don't think that's true, but I think whilst feminism has fought to broaden women's choices, it's also narrowed men's choices. Because in fighting for those choices, it's been demanding that men alter their behaviour. Assumed that men don't need liberating because men are already, they wouldn't be able to do what they like. And I think that is a carry forward. There's a carry forward from the second wave, seeing women as class, seeing women as an underclass, and men as a class above them. I think it's still the same problem of hierarchy. I think it's actually compounded it for men, because choice feminism, whilst it's still implied there's a hierarchy, it's also not giving consistent rules to who it's still presenting as being the oppressor class. If they weren't seen as the oppressor class, it'd be fine. It'd be just general libertarianism for all, wouldn't it? Or liberalism for all. But it isn't. It kind of implies that women, the reason that women don't have all the choices available to them is because of men in some way. And so in order to keep women's choices as broad as possible, we must restrict men's choices. And I think this also means that men are expected to appease very contradictory messages. I mean, that's the problem with choice feminism in the current wave. And I suppose that's what it's our job to counteract that, to make sure that there is a voice for me. Use that. I think the phrase "a voice for men," Pauline might have a copyright on that. I don't know if I can use that. There needs to be an equal fight to make sure that men have a broadening of choices as well, because nothing has been broadening men's choices. Except for having a choice of different women with different choices that we can choose to appease. The assumption that it's men having power that prevents women from having choices means that empowering women is framed as in some way or other disempowering men. Okay, I'm going to talk about personal experience, actually, because many years ago, I can't tell you exactly how many years, 15 years ago, I suppose 16 years ago, you had 9 months on. I think you'll guess what I'm going to say now. A girlfriend asked me, "I'm pregnant, what should I do?" And because the way I've been indoctrinated by the feminist was, it's not up to me. Well, she wanted it to be up to me. She wanted it to be up to me. She wanted me to have an opinion that I expressed one way or the other. I've been told that I wasn't allowed to express an opinion on that. Of course, she wanted me to express an opinion one way or the other. I think that's the thing. I think feminism has left us feeling that we don't have the right to make choices, to make decisions, to express our opinions. And on the subject of choices, especially regarding parenthood, I think the expectation on men, the expectation that men feel still, is that they should do whatever she wants. Happy wife, happy life. Here's a bit of some vintage Ron Farrell.
And when children come along, we say to ourselves, if we're married to a successful woman and we are a successful man, we often find the woman saying, well, now that children are here, I have 3 options. Option 1 is to be full-time involved with the children. Option 2 is to be full-time involved with my work. Option 3 is to do some combination of both. And we men say to ourselves, well, you know, I have 3 options too. Option 1 is work full-time. Option 2 is work full-time. Option 3 is work full-time. So what I'm saying, Deb, is that power is the ability to have control over your own life.
Making it less restrictive. You know, you don't have to wear high-heeled shoes because you're female. You don't have to wear dresses because you're female. You don't have to always do your hair or wear makeup because you're female. You know, these are we are trying to get to a point where people, individuals, are more invested in who they are as individuals as opposed to, am I good at womaning? Am I womaning wrong?
Yeah, whereas we're dealing with arguments made about how we should behave, that use phrases like a real man would do this, a real man would do that. That's something they're dealing with.
And obviously there are some aggressives that are on a different path, but women as a class is the fight of the second wave. And women as individuals is the current horizon, or maybe even the next one. I'm not sure we're there yet. But that's what I'm trying to do. And if you're wondering why my approach to feminism is so different, is that I'm actually presenting an informed perspective for today, an evolution, continuing this dialogue, instead of just replicating something from an era that has a nostalgic appeal, but is right now behind the times.
I kind of liked how she ended there. It's interesting because I started doing like responses to this part in the entire video. So I didn't know how that was going to end either. So it was all surprises for me too. I'm listening to that. Well, partly I almost felt she was, she's stolen my bloody shtick. It's my shtick, that is. I felt like she was saying, this is just a blind man. This is just one blind woman reporting the nature of evidence. That's my shtick. Can't do that. That's my shtick. Still my shtick, Yana. First up, this shouldn't be seen as a gotcha video. It's intended as a gotcha video. Even the first one, even that Lianas trilogy I did, wasn't really intended as a gotcha video. I think by the time I got to doing the Feedback Friday, it was a bit. Because that Feedback Friday really wound me up, so it was a big gotcha. This particular one wasn't. I was taking issues from the deaf. I was responding to some of the points that she raised. So it was more of receiving the ball and then chucking it back. Okay, one of the things I had serious problems with there was advancing the equality of femininity as opposed to advancing the equality of women. I think she's said in the comments at least that she's not happy with the word problematic. And I can see why. You know, so obviously she uses an end of the conversation. You go, well, see, that's problematic. And then that's it. It's problematic to start a conversation. It should be like, okay, this is problematic because, and you still got why it's problematic. It shouldn't be like, oh yeah, I'm not going to deal with that because it's problematic. So I found it problematic that she was saying that she was looking for femininity to be seen as equal to masculinity. Tell you what, I'm going to let my past self say what he's going to say, because that's obviously what I was saying at the time that I was saying, you know what I mean? I've since had some thoughts about the problem with making it femininity versus masculinity, which I'm going to probably put up a video. But there's a problem with the fact that femininity and masculinity is itself subjective. You know, what is subjective to say? What is femininity and what is masculinity? Subjective, because we've all got a combination of both, right? We all have some feminine traits, we all have some masculine traits. And when we sort out what is a feminine trait and how is a masculine trait, we kind of use a bit of bias there. We're kind of biased towards the feminine. We think the feminine is really good. Then we're more likely to see a negative trait as being masculine. If you watch the geek shaming for the girlies, which is the one I've just uploaded, she's obviously decided that being a nerd is a masculine trait. And partly because, you know, nerds tend to be male, and the sort of genre she's talking about can be male. But I kind of think the other reason that she's assigned it as a masculine trait is she doesn't like nerds. So she's gone, oh, that's a masculine trait, because that's a thing I don't like. And that's what makes it masculine. And maybe I do the same. Maybe I do the same in reverse. Maybe I go, I find that to be a feminine trait. Insincerity, I find to be a feminine trait. Because I don't like people who... not just insincerity in general. Insincere, theatrical display of emotion. Like, oh, darling, mwah, mwah, mwah. Oh, that sort of shit. Because that's something that you see women do more often than men do. And men do do it. I do know men. I know men. I'm an actor. Of course I know men that are darlings. But that... like, you work with them. Jobbing actors is different. Up the West End. I know men that are like that, but I do seem to see it as a feminine trait, that whole shallow, theatrical displays of emotion that are insincere. But is that partly because, is that my bias against femininity? Is that because I've got a pro-male bias that I'm going, oh, that's a feminine trait, I don't like that. And I think, not that I'm a misogynist, but I'm just saying I might have a little bit of a bias, we all might have a little bit of a bias. And that is the thing, is you could probably, when you are being biased, load everything you don't like and call it masculinity. Everything you do like, call it femininity. Or vice versa. And I think it takes a little bit of self-reflection to make sure you don't do that. Because the whole thing in the men's rights movement is to say, I don't like the fact that feminists keep talking about toxic masculinity. I kind of buck the trend by turning around and saying, actually, I don't mind talking about toxic masculinity as long as, A, we talk about healthy masculinity too, and B, we also talk about toxic femininity. So that you've got all quadrants covered. Because, of course, we talk about positive femininity all the time, don't we? I'm fine. The other two quadrants are covered. Healthy masculinity, we talk about that, and we talk about toxic femininity. Anyway, there was a feminist there, although a distant feminist. She had turned up in our group mainly because none of the other feminists had talked to her. She'd upset too many of them. She had to retreat to our echo ghetto. There's a feminist there that was saying, well, what's toxic femininity? And I said, well, toxic femininity doesn't kill anyone, does it? I said, well, Munchausen's by proxy, I would say, is a form of toxic femininity, and that does kill people. She said, you can't say Munchausen's by proxy is feminine. Well, it is feminine. The number of men with Munchausen's by proxy is something like 2% of all the cases of Munchausen's by proxy. It is clearly a disorder that is more closely associated with femininity, for obvious reasons. It's a disorder that is about playing the victim and getting attention by creating a situation in which you're helpless. Anyway, she didn't want to acknowledge that was feminine. She didn't want to acknowledge there's anything feminine about Munchausen by proxy. Probably the same way as don't particularly want to acknowledge some things that are far more common amongst men than they are amongst women. Is toxic masculinity. Like fights in pub car parks. You know, that's not mainly masculinity. Maybe it is, maybe it is. Maybe there is such a thing as toxic masculinity. But very biased form of conversing about it if we don't talk about healthy masculinity, talk positively about healthy masculinity, and we are not able to talk about toxic femininity too. Yeah. But I think the thing we've got to be very cautious about is people just, particularly feminists, just labeling everything they don't like as masculinity. some of these things are just as common in women as they are in men. It clearly isn't the right tool for the job. Feminine traits are quite clearly not the right tools for certain jobs. Having said that, feminine traits are the right tools for some other jobs, jobs that I might be quite interested in doing. For example, I don't know, dream interpretation. I used to do a spot of dream interpretation as a psychology student. Now, I have to say here, Freud's dream interpretation stuff is all nonsense. But there is a theory that dreams may be a way of you solving problems by using symbolism, symbolic thinking, as opposed to verbal thinking. You may actually solve problems through dreaming. Sometimes, you know, you can be working on a problem late at night, and then you sleep on it, have a bit of a dream, and you wake up, oh yeah, I got it, I know what it is now. So sometimes dreams can help with problem solving. And I think maybe that is what they're there for. It's sifting through ideas in a kind of a random way. Who knows? Say, I've even found that doing tarot cards can solve problems. The reason they solve problems is not because they really tell the future, because they don't. So yeah, right now I'm very much a materialist in that I don't believe in spirits or deities or being able to tell the future. But because they get you think outside the box and they make you look at things in a perspective that you wouldn't have done before and you're, oh yeah, you hadn't thought about it that way. That makes me see that from a different perspective. And sometimes that irrational thinking that women do, some more intuitive thinking where you sort of think in symbols and stuff, can be useful. Can be the right tool to solve certain problems. But you can't use femininity to solve masculine problems. There's not a feminine way of putting flat-pack furniture together. And that's not to say that women can't put flat-pack furniture together, but when they put flat-pack furniture together, they're using masculine skills. Right? And when I say masculine skills, I don't mean skills that are innately male, because as we've all agreed, as some people have agreed, and actually I agree with them, I agree with the feminists on this, that I agree with the fundamental meaning of what was originally intended by the phrase gender is a social construct. However, I think it has been misused, misapplied, misappropriated. You got the transgender movement are using it for their own ends, and they really don't understand what it means, because if they understood what it meant, then they would understand that it kind of completely negates what they base their identity on. Because they're basing their identity on something which is a social construct. Oh, I identify as a woman. What does that mean? Well, it means that I do womanly things. Well, we've established that as a social construct. So what does it actually mean? It means, just can't fancy that anymore. Okay. I don't feel comfortable being a man. Right. That's an issue, isn't it? I don't feel comfortable being a man. And you are a man. But I don't feel comfortable with that. We need to explore that. Because, you know, men are violent. I'm not violent. Well, perhaps men aren't violent. Perhaps the idea that men are violent is something that we need to discuss. But I'm nurturing. Men aren't nurturing. Maybe men aren't nurturing. Maybe men are nurturing. Maybe being nurturing does not mean that you have. Maybe you don't have to be a woman to be nurturing. So, you know, they are misusing gender as a social construct to mean something else. What the original coiners of that phrase meant was what we see as masculine and what we see as feminine is something we have agreed on as a culture, but that isn't rooted in anything that is truly innately male or truly innately female. It's just an arbitrary divvying out that we've done. I would imagine, to some extent, based on your function. Your function within the culture. And to a certain extent, it may be even taking note of actual natural differences between male and female, natural trends between male and female, and then amplifying them, as it were. So you might notice that women do tend to have, you know, colour blindness is something only boys experience colour blindness, mostly. I think colour blindness is far, far more common in boys. I think it does occur in girls occasionally, but it's very rare. The reason it's very rare in girls and more common in boys is it is a recessive gene on the X chromosome. So when it's in a girl, you have to have both parents with the gene for colour blindness. But when it's in a boy, you only need the woman, you need the mother to have the gene for colour blindness. So boys are far, far more likely to be colour blind than girls are. So when you say girls can see more colours than boys can, girls are, you know, have more aesthetic taste than boys, there's actually a biological basis for there being women having a better predisposition than men. But the amplification of it is to assume that's true of all men and true of all women, rather than just being true of a small number of men and untrue of an even smaller number of women. So yeah, that's a gendering thing that has a small element of innateness there, but our cultural assumption is an exaggeration of, I'm sorry, it's naturally innate. Whether there is an evolutionary psychological background or basis for colorblindness being a male trait, there might be, actually, because it's quite often associated with better night vision. So it's your role within the community to be the night watchman. If you've been camping trip and you take turns going on watch to watch the camp, so if somebody wakes you up at like 3 a.m, it's your watch, you have to patrol the camp for an hour before going back to bed. Something used to do in Cub Scouts. I think it was Cub Scouts. It might be the Inshore Rescue. I did some sort of outward bouncy type stuff, the Inshore Rescue as well. Yeah, if that's your role in the community, obviously that's more likely a masculine role because, you know, it's our role to be protectors, then it's quite possible. Of course, we're hunting as well. I don't know if we're hunted by night. I don't know if when we're hunters, gatherers, we're hunted by night. Anyway, having better night vision, of course, is advantageous if that's your role. So, whether or not it was evolutionarily selected for because of ego psych reasons, or whether it's just chance. Who knows? That's how evolution is. Evolution is just a series of mistakes, isn't it? Evolution's a series of mistakes that were better than the original idea. No, there wasn't the original idea. You know what I mean? That's what they were saying. They were saying that what we think of as masculine and feminine is something we've decided between us culturally. It isn't based on anything real. There's no masculine trait that a woman can't have. There's no feminine trait that a man can't have. There are things that women can do that men can't. For example, breastfeed, give birth. And there are things that men can do that women can't. Like pee standing up, unless there's a device attached, a she-wee or something. Or she's quite happy to get urine all over her legs. But when it comes to the mind, there's nothing really that is so masculine that no woman has that trait. And there's nothing so feminine that no man has that trait. We're kind of a mix of things that culturally be considered masculine and culturally be considered feminine. And that's what was meant by gender as a social construct. It was never intended to mean you can be whatever gender you like, just make it up. That's why people need to get, people now saying, feeling the need to say, oh, I'm gender fluid. Don't need to say gender fluid. Everyone's a mishmosh. It's okay to be a mishmosh. You don't have to give a special name for being a mishmosh. We all are. The only reason you need to do that is because you know, you have the transgender saying to you, so what gender are you? What gender do you identify as? You go, well, I don't. Most people, when asked, what gender do you identify as, we go, the one I am. And if they're not really thinking about what gender is, and they think gender is the same as sex, they go, well, yeah, I'm the one I am. I've got a penis, so I'm male. That's all I am. But if they're actually thinking about it as gender being something different from your sex, then they'll be going, well, I don't really have one. I'm not really that bothered. And I go, no, you must have, because I've got one. It's, you know, it's the opposite to what I am. It's the opposite to what my sex is. Oh, I must have one. I suppose I'm sort of, I don't know, just sort of fluid, really. It's gender fluid. Don't we need the term gender fluid? Everyone's a mishmash. Yes, I took issue with that. Obviously, I took issue with patriarchy, which is a biggie, really. No, women haven't historically been oppressed, and even if you're not calling it oppression, whilst status in the public sphere tends to follow along patrilineal lines, there is a lot of cultures carried along matrilineal lines. So women have actually played a role in shaping culture. That's how you get the male supremacists saying, we built this civilization. The physicals, yeah, the buildings, the borders, we're the physical shapers of our civilization, but in terms of culture, women were the women dictated what was socially appropriate, and that followed along matrilineal lines. Was the third thing she defined was privilege. Yeah, didn't like privilege because you suggested it was hierarchical, which means that you don't understand that, in fact, certainly with gender, there's advantages and disadvantages on both sides. Whereas privilege suggests that the higher up the hierarchy you go, the more advantages you get. I don't think that is true of the sexes. I think that when it comes to the sexes and the sexes' roles, the role of the sexes, I think the advantages and disadvantages kind of trade off. And then misogyny, completely agree with you, and I said the same about misogyny as well. We often do that, and I've started to notice it, and I started to call it out. You know, I should do my misogyny. That you're talking about, a gender bias that is, or sexual bias against males, but it isn't misogyny. It's not even. Lastly, sexism. Yeah, I think it's a big problem actually that people don't want to. You tell people they're sexist, they've been sexist, they think you're telling them off. We're all sexist, sometimes. We all do things that are sexist, we all say things that are sexist. I think perhaps we should be more forgiving of sexism, rather than treating it like you've just been told you hate women. You don't hate women, you just be sexist. You don't hate men, you just be sexist. We all have little biases. We are innately biased in favour of women, generally, I mean, as we all kind of have innate benevolent sexism to all women. Actually, funnily enough, the exception, because they did a study on this, the exception is men that like sex but are sexually inexperienced. So basically, sexually frustrated men. So it's true. Misogynists really are. Misogynists, they can't get a girl. It's a bit awkward. But a real pain in the ass as well when you're kind of trying to talk about men's issues and things. Do you have a girlfriend? It's completely irrelevant because I'm not actually speaking out of bitterness or anger. I am talking about the issues as they are. It's nothing to do with whether or not I've had any nookie lately.
not your business.
I tell you what I'd like to do in response to this. Quite close up another response video. I'd like to do a glossary of my terms. Glossary of terms that we use. So that you understand them. Because some of them cross over, you know. I remember a couple of years back, an MRA who's kind of a bit more of a tradc on MRA than myself took issue with us in the MRM using the word gynocentricism. And he was saying, oh, this gynocentricism is a bit ridiculous. It's ridiculous. Everything's gynocentricism. You think everything's gynocentric. So this gynocentricism has become the MRA equivalent of patriarchy. So he said, well, maybe patriarchy and gynocentricism are the same thing. I said, you know, in a way it is. Because if patriarchy is the idea that men have duty of care, right? Who are they caring for? They're caring for women. And gynocentricism is the idea that everyone should care for women. So actually, yeah, patriarchy and gynocentricism is the same thing. It's two different ways of looking at the same thing. And I think that's exemplified in an article called, If There's One Feminist Concept You Should Learn, It's This One, which is by, I can't remember the writer now, but he's got a website called Equality Agnostic. And the feminist theory that he's talking about is a first wave feminist theory, really ties in very heavily with Wollstonecraft and Ibsen, I think, if you're familiar with the Doll's House. And it's women as children, men as parents. It's women, it's about women being treated as children by men who act as though they're the parents of the women that they, you know, have to care for. And basically, the way this is put forward, you go, yeah, I can see how, from the female perspective, that's patriarchy that's described in there. And from the male perspective, I can describe it as gynocentricism. It's quite a unifying little article that made you think, well, maybe patriarchy gains gynocentricism is the same thing. Seen from two different angles. So I think there is worth, actually comparing terms and going, you know that thing that you call benevolent sexism? I call that gynolatry. And sometimes I call it misandry. Because some of the things you listed there under benevolent sexism was actually misandry. You can say, you know, the idea that women are innocent is benevolent sexism. The idea that men are predators isn't benevolent sexism, it's misandry. If a feminist can't have misandry in their vocabulary, there is a serious problem. If the feminist thinks the sexism is just one way, there's a serious problem in terms of our ability to communicate. But I think our ability to communicate would be improved if we also shared our glossary of terms. So I might do a little one on our glossary of terms. And I'll talk about that. That's another video of another day.